Rise of Indian Atheism, Part 3. Now we are going to identify and understand the atheist tendencies that have taken place in Indian culture and religion. In this particular context, we have to identify the concept and impact and function of Buddhism. Buddhism was a religion very much known only in the 6th century BC. And prior to, there was no tradition of Buddhism as has been identified in Jainism. That means it can be understood that Buddhism was a religion which was very much contemporaneous, rather present continuous, in the 6th century BC only. And prior to, there was no prophet at all. The Buddhism was called so after the prophet Buddha, the realized. The word Buddha indicates the realized. His name was Siddhartha. He was from a princely family of Shakyas of Kapilavastupura. His father was Suddhodana. His mother was Mayadevi. He was born at a place called as Lumbini Vana. The entire biography of Buddha is very much interesting, and it indicates a query into the truth, an understanding the person, and the development of the personality. All these three put together becomes the Buddha. And Buddha's identity in a biographic sense can be seen in 5 Kalyanas, which are mentioned in the Buddhist literature as the birth, the great renunciation, the realization, the first sermon, and also the Mahaparinirvana. These are all considered to be the important events in the biography of the Buddha. And actually, in order to understand the Buddhist religion, the Buddhist philosophy, and the Buddhist way of approach to the life and lifestyle management, there are some important sources. For example, the Pitakas were there. They were called as Sutta Pitaka, Vinaya Pitaka, and Abhidhamma Pitaka. There was another variety of the books called as Nikayas, like Anguttara Nikaya. There are also another variety of books called as Sutras, like Lankavatara Sutra, Mahaparinibbana Sutta. And there were some Jataka tales, which are a later edition. And the works like Avadana Kalpalata, which are belonging to the later period. This entire Buddhist literature is primarily written in Pali language. And subsequently, Sanskrit was also adopted in Buddhism. Now, the basic concept here is how to understand the approach to life, how the Buddha has become the role model in understanding his own life, how Buddhist identities are going to speak about for the lifestyle management. And therein, the Buddha is considered to be a person who is facing a regular way of life. He has seen the suffering elsewhere. The birth is a suffering. The family life is a suffering. The disease is a suffering. All these things are found by Buddha. And he wanted to find out the truth. And for that, he had gone through some of the discourses of Sankhya, Charvaka, and other traditions. But actually, he was not satisfied. The Buddhist concept lies in the renunciation of the world and going away in order to find out and cultivate an inner vision. This is the concept of the enlightenment of the Buddha. The Buddha's enlightenment has given rise to the world, a new path for understanding the body, mind, and character. The Buddhist identity is considered to be very, very important and significant in promoting the rise of the atheism. The Buddhist concept is rising around three important things. One is called as the Arya Satyas. Buddha identifies four Arya Satyas are the noble truths. He says the desires are the reason for the suffering. And the suffering is making the person to live for so many other things. So he must get rid of the suffering. And for getting rid of the suffering, the only point is the Ashtanga Marga, or the eight-limbed path, or eightfold path. In this way, Buddha suggests a problem and a solution. The problem is suffering. The problem is worry. The problem is old age. The problem is very survival itself. And for that, he will be identifying the Ashtanga Marga, or eightfold path. It is considered to be the only solution in order to cross the levels. And here, it is very, very interesting that the Buddha is not questioning the birth. The Buddha is not questioning the death. Buddha is not questioning the rebirth. He is very much particular about the action and the result. That means, he is very much contemporary to the living itself. For him, the lifestyle management and the living and understanding the living and trying to understand the living through the living is very, very important. And that is why Buddha is not having any role model. Buddha is not having any scriptures. Buddha is not having any tradition. He is present to the core. In such a situation, the Buddhist thought rallied around understanding and managing what we call as the body, mind and character. What is very important in the body, mind and character? The speech is more important. The character is more important. The vision is more important. The behavior is more important. In this way, Buddha has covered the eightfold path, which will be contemporarily identifying the interrelationship between the body, mind and character. Here, the character is the inbuilt identity of an individual. Mind is the functional identity of the individual. Body is the expressive identity of the individual. Here, the Ashtanga Marga tries to bridge the gap between the motor organs, which are of explicit behavior, the sense organs, which are of implicit behavior, and the mind, which is subconscious behavior. He wants to identify the entire behavioral traits into a particular mold, which is called as the eightfold path. The concept of eight can be identified by the later observations as having relationship with the eight types of nature. Here, the concept of Buddha's identity of eight can be taken to the five elements, the mind, the intellect, and the ego. Buddha wanted to stretch for the ego. He wanted to question the ego. He has made a penance for a longer time and he had to try to understand his own thoughts and has perceived himself. And after his perception, he has identified this particular Ashtanga Marga. And how to implement this particular Ashtanga Marga is very, very important. And for that, he has identified a total submission, a bodily submission, a social submission, and a conscious submission. These are three varieties of submission. Submission makes a person relieved of ego. As a result, man will not be carried away by the desires, which will be making him desire-free. And then he will be free from the suffering. And for that, the only path is submission. And that is why he suggested three varieties of Sharanam. That is called as Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, Dharmam Sharanam Gacchami, Buddham Sharanam Gacchami. Man is a social animal. He must be submissive to the society. He has to accept the social law. All the individual pursuits, individual behavior, they must be submissive to the society. That is indicative of the Sangham Sharanam Gacchami. Man must be carried by a morality. He must be of ethical character. Ethics must be an inbuilt identity. And that is why Dharmam Sharanam Gacchami. The third one is the Buddha or the Prophet. The commitment to the Prophet is considered to be very, very important. ఇట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ యాజ్ బుద్ధం శరణం గచ్చామి. ది ఇంపార్టెంట్ ఆస్పెక్ట్ ఇన్ దిస్ పర్టికులర్ డైమెన్షన్ ఈజ్ దెర్ ఈస్ నో కల్ట్ ప్రీవియస్లీ, దెర్ ఇస్ నో ట్రెడిషన్ ప్రీవియస్లీ. బుద్ధ ఈజ్ వెరీ మచ్ కంటెంపరేనియస్ టు ది పర్ఫెక్ట్ అండ్ హీ వాంటెడ్ టు మైండ్ అవుట్ అండ్ కార్వ్ అవుట్ ఏ పర్టికులర్ సిస్టమ్ ఆఫ్ ది కాన్షియస్నెస్ మైండ్ అండ్ బాడీ విత్ ది బిల్ట్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ క్యారెక్టర్ దస్ ఎమర్జ్డ్ ది బుద్ధిజం యాజ్ ప్యూర్లీ ఎ నావెల్ అండ్ మోడర్న్ థాట్ ఇన్ ఎథీజం డ్యూరింగ్ 6th century BC.